So in previous lecture, we saw few repairs of inguinal hernia. Now we'll see other what are the other types of hernia repair. So now we come to McVeigh-Cooper's ligament repair. In this, the transverse abdomen is aponeurosis, along with transversalis fascia is sutured to Cooper's ligament and iliopubic tract. This operation is similar to Bassani's repair, except that Cooper's ligament instead of inguinal ligament is used for medial portion of the repair. Now we'll talk something about relaxing incision. So relaxing incision divides the anterior rectus sheath. So you may be asked a question, the relaxing sheath is used to divide which part of inguinal canal. So they may give you option like transverse abdominis aponeurosis or external oblique aponeurosis. It is not external oblique aponeurosis, it is not transversalis fascia, it is anterior rectus sheath. So it extends from pubic tubercle superiorly to a variable distance. It is like hockey stick incision. So in this figure, you can see that relaxing incision can be given like this over the medial aspect of anterior rectus sheath. The rectus muscle itself is strong and it will prevent future incisional herniation even though it is incised. The relaxing incision works by allowing the various components of abdominal wall to displace laterally and inferiorly. So once this relaxing incision is given, you can easily suture the conjoint tendon to the inguinal ligament without much tension. Now we'll see what is Mercy's repair. It is indicated in Nyhart's type 1 indirect inguinal hernia where internal ring is normal. Prosthetic material is avoided. It features high ligation of the hernial sac plus narrowing of the internal ring. So internal ring is narrowed and cord structures are taken laterally. So the cord structures are displaced laterally and the sutures are taken through muscular and facial layers medial to the cord. After seeing what are different types of herniorrhaphies, now we'll see what is hernioplasty. So it is high ligation with inversion of sac plus reinforcement of the defect with synthetic material. It is tension free. The most commonly performed hernioplasty is Lichtenstein's repair. It has got a recurrence rate of less than 0.1%. What are the prosthetic material qualities? So how the ideal prosthetic material is selected? It is not modified by any tissue fluid. It is chemically inert. It does not cause inflammatory or foreign body reaction. It is not carcinogenic. It does not cause allergic or hypersensitivity response. It is resistant to mechanical strain. It is pliable and therefore it can be molded to fit into various curves of inguinal canal. It can be easily sterilized. So you may be asked question, ideal prosthetic material is all of the following except. So they may put, it may not be easily sterilized, or carcinogenic is the thing which may confuse you, or it should be pliable and moldable. So you may think, how can it be pliable and moldable? It should be firm. So these are the things which should be kept in mind. Nowadays, you can have absorbable and non-absorbable components together. So it is called as composite mesh. So now we will go through various types of hernioplasties. So we can have open anterior prosthetic repair in which Lichtenstein's tension-free hernioplasty is done most commonly. It is done by a mesh which contains minimal size of 15 cm by 8 cm. For an adult, it is positioned over an inguinal floor. The medial end is secured to the anterior rectus sheath. So this medial end is secured to the anterior rectus sheath, a minimum of 2 cm medial to the pubic tubercle. So this pubic tubercle covers 2 cm by the mesh. So mesh is very much overlapping pubic tubercle. So you may be asked, the ideal size of mesh in Lichtenstein repair is following. So they may give you 15 by 10, 15 by 8 or 15 by 15. But 15 by 8 is the minimum size required. You can use non-absorbable or sutures which can be delayed absorbable. So once you go through the deep ring, a slit is made at the lateral end of the mesh, creating two tails. A single interrupted suture is used to secure the lower edge of superior tail to the inferior edge of the inferior tail, in effect creating a shutter wall of internal ring. So you should be carefully reading this sentence, the inferior edge of superior tail. So superior tail has got this inferior edge. So inferior is sutured to the inferior edge of lower margin. So you should be going through sentence very carefully. So the two tails will overlap like this. It is not sutured like this, but it is sutured like this. This step is considered to be crucial for prevention of indirect recurrences that are occasionally seen when simple Reaux approximation of the tail is performed. So this is very important because it will prevent the shutter mechanism at the deep ring. So you may be asked question on these lines. The tails are overlap because to approximate to narrow the deep ring or to preserve the shutter mechanism of deep ring. So they make you options. You have to choose to preserve shutter mechanism of deep ring. Next we have got plug and patch technique developed by Gilbert and modified by Rutko and Robbins and others. So in which the mesh plug is used to reinforce the defect in the posterior wall. So it may be either sutured to the defect of direct hernia or it may be sutured to the deep ring. Next we have got open preperitoneal prosthetic repairs. The principle of preperitoneal or prosthetic repairs is the placement of large prosthesis in the preperitoneal space between transversalis fascia and the peritoneum, in effect replacing transversalis fascia. So this is very important. The preperitoneal repair will replace transversalis fascia, so it will add to the strength of transversalis fascia. So you may be asked question, in preperitoneal repair which of the following structures is reinforced? It may be transversalis fascia. They may give options like transversalis fascia, muscle, but it is the transversalis fascia. You have to choose correct. The transversalis fascia, it is becoming the deficient in its function. That's why it needs to be reinforced. You have got various options in this. There can be anterior approach of Reed and Reeves. There can be posterior approach. So anterior approach is same through floor of the inguinal canal, in which you have to slit open the inguinal canal and the mesh is put behind the transversalis fascia on the peritoneum. In posterior approach, you have got various types like wand, stopas and Reeves. So it is giant prosthetic reinforcement of the visceral sac called as GPRVS. The term parietalization of the spermatic cord, popularized by Stopa, refers to the thorough dissection of the cord to provide enough length to move it laterally. So in hernia repair, parietalization of the cord means, so they may give 4 or 5 lines. So this is the proper answer, parietalization. You may think it may be parietalization of the peritoneum, but it is not parietalization of the peritoneum, but it is parietalization of the spermatic cord. It is important to stay in the plane between peritoneum and transversalis fascia. So these two planes are very important for preperitoneal repair. Next we have got Kugel and Ugaharis repair. These open preperitoneal prosthetic repairs were developed to compete with the laparoscopic repairs by using a small 2 to 3 cm incision, 2 to 3 cm above internal ring. So in which the incision is made on the skin over the deep ring, and from there they used to enter in the preperitoneal space and the mesh is spread all around once you create a small incision. So the incision was taken lateral to the inferior epigastric vessels on the posterior wall. There can be combination of anterior preperitoneal prosthetic repair. You can call it as bilayer prosthetic repair. Friends, now we'll go to minimal invasive laparoscopic repair of inguinal hernias. We have got various varieties. The first one is called as TAPP, which is transabdominal preperitoneal repair. Then you have got intraperitoneal onlay mesh repair. Next we have got TEP, that is totally extraperitoneal laparoscopic repair. So these names are confusing once you have heard them on the first time, but they are very easy to understand. In TAPP, that is transabdominal, you go across the peritoneal cavity, you incise the peritoneum, and then you create a space between transversalis fascia and peritoneum. But in TEP, you directly go between peritoneum and transversalis fascia, remaining in the extraperitoneal space. In TEP, you do not enter in the peritoneal cavity. So these are very two important differences. So you may be asked a question, the laparoscopic hernia through which the peritoneum is entered is called TEP, TAPP. So you have to answer, when there is peritoneal breach or peritoneum is entered, it is TAPP or IPOM. So friends, you have to go through these names and remember them. In laparoscopic repair, staples or tacks are never placed below iliopubic tract when lateral to the spermatic vessels to minimize the chance of damage to the lateral scutaneous nerve of the thigh or femoral branch of genital femoral nerve. So this is very important point to remember. So lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh can be injured when you put staples lateral to the internal spermatic vessel or iliopubic tract. So these two structures are very important to be preserved, that is lateral cutaneous nerve and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. So you may be asked question, the nerve which are damaged commonly in laparoscopic repair are, so these are lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. Having learned what you mean by TAPP or TEP, we now briefly go through laparoscopical anatomy of the anteriabdominal wall when seen from inside. So this is anatomy when seen from outside, but now we'll see anatomy when seen from inside. So you have got median umbilical ligament. So this is pubic symphysis seen from inside, and this is the inside view of the anteriabdominal wall and the groin. So we have got median fold, which is called as median umbilical ligament. Then we have got one more fold which is a bit lateral to the median, which is medial umbilical ligament. Next we have one more fold of peritoneum, it is called as lateral umbilical ligament. So these three things are to be remembered. So median umbilical fold contains urachus, the medial umbilical fold contains obliterated umbilical artery, and the lateral umbilical fold contains inferior epigastric vessels. So these three things should be remembered, because all the sentences on all the repairs are in with respect to these ligaments. So these ligaments create fossae. These are called medial fossa, lateral fossa and supravesical fossa. So supravesical fossa is the fossa between median and medial umbilical ligament. So it is above the bladder. Then we have got the medial fossa. So medial fossa between medial umbilical ligament and lateral umbilical ligament, and lateral fossa is lateral to the lateral umbilical ligament. So friends, from laparoscopic perspective, it is the direct hernia which occurs through medial fossa, and these are the indirect hernias which occur through lateral fossa. Next we have got the preperitoneal spaces. So these spaces are very important because they are cave of Retzius and space of Bogross. So you may be asked a question, what do you mean by cave of Retzius? So it is the retropubic space which is bound laterally to the fusion of the inferior epigastric artery to the peritoneum. So from this area to this area in the retropubic space, it is called as cave of Retzius. Superiorly it extends up to the umbilicus and lower to the pelvic floor. Lateral to this is space of Bogross. So you can say technically space of Bogross is a lateral continuation of cave of Retzius. So these two spaces are important because preperitoneal repairs are done in this area. Now we'll go through various nerves. We just revise because you may be asked questions on these nerves relating to the inguinal canal. So ilioinguinal nerve, it enters inguinal canal by piercing internal oblique muscle and not deep ring. So this is very important. So ilioinguinal nerve which enters the inguinal canal, it pierces internal oblique muscle, not the deep ring. It then emerges from superficial inguinal ring to supply skin of proximomedial skin of thigh, skin over penile root and upper part of the scrotum. Next we have got iliohypogastric nerve. It divides into two branches, the lateral cutaneous and anterior cutaneous. The lateral cutaneous supplies posterolateral gluteal skin and anterior cutaneous supplies suprapubic skin. Next we have got the genitofemoral nerve. It divides into two branches, which are genital and femoral. The genital branch of genitofemoral nerve enters the inguinal canal at its deep ring and supplies cremaster muscle and scrotal skin. And femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve passes behind inguinal ligament and enters the femoral sheath lateral to the femoral artery. It pierces the anterior layer of femoral sheath and fascia lata and supplies skin anterior to the upper part of femoral triangle. So we have got nerves which lie on the lateral side of the vessels which go through the thigh. So we have got genitofemoral nerve which divides in the genital branch and femoral branch, and the lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh. In relation to the various anatomical structures of the groin seen from inside, we have got various triangles. So these are called triangle of doom. It is an inverted V-shaped area. So you can imagine a triangle which is inverted V-shaped area with its apex at the deep ring. So apex at the deep ring and it is bound by laterally by the gonadal vessels. So these are gonadal vessels on the lateral side and vas deferens on the medial side. So it contains the external iliac vessels. So vas deferens or round ligament on the medial side and gonadal vessels on the lateral side. So this is called triangle of doom. So you may be asked boundaries of triangle of doom. What are the contents of triangle of doom? These are external iliac artery, external iliac vein, deep circumference iliac vein, genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. So genitofemoral nerve, it enters in the triangle of doom, and femoral nerve which is deep on the triangle. Next we have got triangle of pain. So triangle of pain, which are boundaries of inferomedially gonadal vessels and superolaterally iliopubic tract. So triangle of pain can be imagined like this. So it has got boundaries of gonadal vessels and iliopubic tract. The contents of the triangle of pain are lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, anterior femoral cutaneous nerve and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve along with femoral nerve. So you can see all the nerves are mainly located in triangle of pain. So friends, you can see these two triangles, they are very important from laparoscopic point of view. Next we have got circle of death or corona mortis. This is one more area which in relation with the laparoscopic anatomy. It is formed by anastomosis of aberrant obturator artery or vein arising from external iliac or inferior epigastric with the normal obturator vessel arising from the internal iliac. So it is aberrant obturator. So corona mortis or circle of death, here the one artery which goes to the obturator artery, it travels to the retropubic space, it will traverse over the pubic bone. So this artery when injured can cause torrential bleeding. So you may not see that bleeding during laparoscopy, but as the abdomen is deflated, these veins start bleeding. So along with these two structures, so the two triangles, that is triangle of doom and triangle of pain, we have got square or trapezoid of doom. So it is formed by these two triangles. So these two triangles, that is triangle of doom containing vessels and triangle of pain containing nerves, these two triangles form the square of doom. So all these terminologies are very confusing. You should go through these terminologies very carefully, because you may be asked which are the following contents of triangle of pain. All of the following contents of triangle of pain are except, and contents of the triangle of doom are except, and main artery injured in corona mortis is following. So all these types of permutation combination questions can be asked on this laparoscopic anatomy of inguinal canal. Friends, now we go to the indications of laparoscopic repair. A recurrent hernia after open repair, because the operation is performed in normal planes. Once you have got violated plane from anterior side and you have got recurrence, you can go through laparoscopic repair for the recurrence. Bilateral hernias as on both sides can be easily repaired using a small laparoscopic incision. So same incisions can be used to go on the both sides. The presence of an inguinal hernia in a patient who requires laparoscopy for other procedure like cholecystectomy you are doing and patient has got inguinal hernia, you can combine both procedures provided the cholecystitis patient is not having acute attack and his bile is culture negative. There are absolute contraindications to laparoscopic hernia repair. These are signs of intra-abdominal infection or coagulopathy. So this form the absolute contraindication. So intra-abdominal infection is there, you cannot put mesh from inside. There are relative contraindications in the form like intra-abdominal adhesions from previous surgery, ascites or previous surgery in a space of radius because of the increased risk to the bladder, severe underlying medical illness, incarcerated sliding scrotal hernia containing sigmoid colon can be relative contraindication because you may not able to reduce the hernial content easily. So these contraindication and indication should be remembered well, because you may be asked questions. So friends, having learned the laparoscopic repair of inguinal hernia, now we'll go through a repair of femoral hernia. Just before we see femoral hernia repair, we'll see what are the differential diagnosis points of femoral hernia, because it is an entity in the groin where all other structures can confuse clinical diagnosis. Most common femoral hernial differential diagnosis will be an inguinal hernia. Next comes the siphonavirix. Next is the enlarged femoral lymph node, because it may be sitting on the same side. You can have a lipoma over the femoral canal mimicking as femoral hernia. A femoral artery aneurysm can mimic as a femoral hernia. A psoas abscess, which travels to psoas sheath and enters to the medial part of the thigh, is situated at the exactly the same site of the femoral hernia. You can have distended psoas bursa pointing over the medial aspect of the thigh. You can have ruptured head of adductor longus, which may have crumpled at the upper part of the thigh, mimicking as a swelling at the medial part of the thigh. So all these things should be remembered. So femoral hernia should be differentiated from all of the below except. So you have to answer and choose accordingly. Next, we have various varieties of femoral hernia, such as hydrocele of femoral hernial sac. When the neck of the sac becomes plugged with the omentum or adhesions, the hydrocele of the sac results. So when femoral hernia comes through the femoral canal and the neck is plugged by and the contents go on distending, it forms hydrocele. We have got Laugier's femoral hernia, which is a hernia through a gap in the lacunar or gimbernous ligament. The diagnosis is based on the unusual medial position of small femoral hernial sac. So hernia, when it is very much medially, it is Laugier's femoral hernia. The hernia being from very small cavity, it always strangulated. So all these definitions should be known to you because you may be asked questions. Next, we have got Narratt's femoral hernia. It occurs only in patients with congenital dislocation of hip and is the result of lateral displacement of psoas muscle. The hernia lies hidden behind femoral vessels. We have got Cloquet's hernia. A Cloquet's hernia is one in which the sac lies under the fascia covering the pectineus muscle. The strangulation is likely and the sac may coexist with usual types of femoral hernial sac. Now we go through the treatment options for femoral hernia. We have got low operation of Lockwood, high operation of MacUVD, and inguinal operation of Lothisian. So in low operation, you incise the femoral hernial sac in the groin below inguinal ligament and then you go through the femoral sac. Here the sac layers are incised and you access the contents of the sac. In high operation of MacUVD, you take perpendicular incision over medial part of the sac. It is extended upwards across the inguinal ligament over the medial aspect of the rectus sheath. So once you go from thigh to the lower part of abdomen, you go deep, you have got control over the both the sac and the structure which is coming from the femoral canal. Here you enter the preperitoneal space behind the medial part of the inguinal canal. Here the inguinal canal is entered on the medial aspect of its floor and you enter the preperitoneal space from where the sac of the femoral canal will be going down across the femoral sheath. So differences of operation should be noted. So low operation of Lockwood is mainly in thigh. High operation of MacUVD has got both components like in thigh and also in groin going through preperitoneal space. The third operation is Lothisian. So Lothisian operation is mainly through the inguinal floor. So third operation deals only through the inguinal floor. You will go preperitoneally through the inguinal floor where you access the structures going in the femoral canal. Here you suture conjoint tendon to the Cooper's ligament or ligament over the pectin pubis. So this is very important thing. Whatever be the name of operation, you repair these femoral hernias by approximating conjoint tendon to the Cooper's ligament. These femoral hernias can also be repaired laparoscopically. As we have seen down, we have got great view of all the myopectineal orifice of future from laparoscopic approach. So here the tape repair visualizing the femoral canal and iliac vessels from preperitoneal approach is done. It will enable safe reduction of the hernial sac while monitoring iliac vessels under direct vision. So femoral hernia occurs just medial to the femoral vein. So you can have great view from laparoscopic and you have to place mesh over the myopectineal orifice of Richard to cover this hernia. Friends, we have gone through various types of hernial surgery. The laparoscopic one, the femoral one, how to deal with various hernias. Now we'll see what are the complications of hernia surgery. So we have got recurrence as the main complication. Next, we have got the chronic groin pain, which is called as inguinodynia. Next, we can have cord and testicular complications in the form of hematoma formation, ischemic orchitis, testicular atrophy, disejaculation. So disejaculation is due to the injury to the genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. So you may be asked a question, Disejaculation is because of injury to the wish structure. You may divide vas deferens accidentally. There can be hydrocele formation or testicular descent because you may injure cremaster muscle. You may have injury to the urinary bladder or wound may get infected. There can be seroma formation or hematoma formation which may be in the wound or in the scrotum or in the retroperitoneal if the vessel inferior epigastric or any other vessels is injured. There can be osteitis pubis if the stitch is taken too much deep in the pubic periosteum. Now we'll go through what is hernia accident. So whenever the hernia gets complicated, it is called as hernia accident. We have got incarceration of hernia, which is irreducible hernia. The recommended treatment is surgery. So initial treatment in absence of sign of strangulation will be taxis. So you reduce the sac, it is called as taxis. So you should be careful of reduction en masse, in which the ring is as it is, you reduce all contents with its intact ring in the retroperitoneum. So reduction en masse is a complication of taxis. Next we have got bowel obstruction, because strangulation if not relieved or obstruction not relieved, bowel will get obstructed. Usually it may not be partial. So you should look at the groin. Incarceration proceeds to the obstruction, it will proceed to the strangulation. So strangulation is a serious and life threatening. In strangulation, hernia is very tense and tender. So first sign to occur in strangulation is tenderness. So you may be asked patient, which of the following signs is the first to appear in the strangulation? Skin may be discolored with reddish or bluish hue. You may have got Richter's hernia in strangulation, in which the part or edge of the bowel may get strangulated without the whole bowel loop getting strangulated. So Richter's hernia is the in which the only part of circumference of the bowel enters the hernia sac. Therefore, complete obstruction and absolute constipation is rare. Even if the hernial contents get incarcerated and strangulated. Strangulated Richter's hernia is particularly noteworthy as operation is frequently delayed because patient's clinical signs will mimic as gastroenteritis. So you may have bowel knuckle getting obstructed, from below the bowel contents will be flowing. You may have the continuity of the bowel tract. So the local signs of strangulation are often not obvious. The patient may not vomit while the colicky pain is present. The bowels are often open normally or there may be diarrhea. Absolute constipation is delayed until paretic ileus supervenes some of the part of bowel necrosis. For these reasons, the gangrene of the neck of the bowel and perforations occurs before surgery in case of Richter's hernia. Richter's hernia you may have in any part of the hernia. You may have of the anterior abdominal wall or you may have in the groin also. Patient will have leukocytosis, he will be toxic, dehydrated, febrile and metabolic acidosis there in case of complicated hernia. So you have to treat this with resuscitation, electrolyte replacement, antibiotics, nasogastric tube decompression. Surgery is by open inguinal hernia incision in cases of hernia accident. So whenever you have got strangulated hernia, you have to operate immediately. If the bowel is viable, it is reduced into abdominal cavity and hernia repair is done. If the bowel is obviously gangrenous, you have to resect with end-to-end anastomosis and hernia is repaired without mesh. So you have to remember, in obviously gangrenous, you should not put mesh. If hernia has got reduced before you operate, you have to suspect that if the bowel is gangrenous, you have to proceed with exploratory laparotomy. And if you have got laparoscope with you, you can just put a laparoscope and confirm the reduced bowel is viable or not. So friends, we saw various types of hernia repair and complications of hernia and complications in such form of hernia accident in which the hernial contents get acutely obstructed and strangulated. Thank you.